Now let's talk about gameplay animation. From prototype, we defined our goals. The first was to achieve the most realistic animation possible. We didn't want to make any excuses for the motion being unrealistic just because this was a game. And the other goal was to never let aesthetics trump control. In other words, we didn't want to put visuals before gameplay or vice versa, but we knew that striking a perfect balance would require rethinking a lot of traditional approaches to game animation systems. Next, we identified some common characteristics of game animation that break immersion. First, we have abrupt transitions. Blending between two animations is often very noticeable and breaks the illusion of reality. And because of previous limitations, idle and move cycle animations can often be very repetitive. And since the Order 1886 was based on strafing, which means you can face one direction while moving in any direction, we had to think about strafe blending. This can be accomplished in a number of ways, but often doesn't feel natural. Games usually adjust animation playback speed to add more sensitivity to the control, but this can often lead to slow-mo or fast-forward-looking animation. And last, we have animation layer and split body, which are useful features, but sometimes they lead to the characters feeling like parts of their bodies are disconnected. Let's start with abrupt transitions. One of the biggest issues with games is harsh blending. We typically see one animation abruptly change to another in a tenth of a second, which breaks immersion. So here's our philosophy on animation transitions. First, if you don't need multiple animations, avoid the transition entirely. There are still places where you need quick blending. Players expect immediate feedback on input, but all other blending should be invisible to the player. A good example of an unnecessary transition can be found in stand idles. They're typically made up of multiple, short animations that randomly cycle. The seams are noticeable, and the movement becomes very recognizable after thousands of views. The solution was something we learned from our friends at Naughty Dog, to simply have one long idle. This removed the repetitive quality and kept the motions from becoming recognizable. It also removed almost all the seams and gave us the opportunity to have more natural performances. But now that we had long idles, a new challenge presented itself. Typically, anytime a player moves, it restarts the idle from the beginning. The result is that we only see the first few seconds of the idle over and over, no matter how long it is. To fix this, we implemented a resume feature. Whenever an idle is interrupted, it remembers where it left off. Whenever the character begins idling again, it picks up from there. Now let's talk about quick blending. Simple, fast blending still has an important place in games. On inputs like hitting a button, deflecting or releasing the stick, the user expects immediate feedback, so a quick blend in this circumstance feels appropriate. All other blends should be smooth and seamless. Here's where things start getting interesting. Ideally, transitions that aren't triggered by the player should be so transparent that the player doesn't even know it happened. This goal led us to develop two important blending features. Transitioning into an idle uses settle blending, and transitioning into movement uses phase blending. We'll talk about both of these in depth. Since our idles can resume playing from any point, we couldn't just end on a pose that matched the idle because there was no standard idle pose anymore. To fix this, we created settle blends. Here's an example involving run-stop animations. After a short action portion where the feet plant, the settle is a long cross-blend between the run-stop and the idle animation. This makes it very difficult to tell where one animation ends and the other begins. We tried anything from a half a second to 3 seconds, but we found that the sweet spot for settle blends is about 1 second long. Next, we tackle blending into movement. In reality, beginning to run requires complex and recognizable body mechanics. Mocap gave us believable motion, but blending into movement was the tricky part. In previous games, we matched the end frame of the move start animation with the first frame of the move cycle. This isn't very scalable when you have hundreds of move start animations. And even if all the poses match, the movement of all the body parts won't without a huge amount of cleanup. Lastly, move starts are usually too short. Games expedite them to get the characters into move cycles as fast as possible. This detracts from the believability because the weight shift required to start moving tends to last more than a few steps. The solution to all of these issues is phase blending. So what are phases? They're designated sections of move cycles which are used to synchronize animations, regardless of move speed, animation timing, direction of movement, or number of cycles. Animators tag each animation, identifying which phases fall on which frames. The engine then reads these tags and blends animations together using a phase clock, which progressively averages the phases of all the animations playing. Here's an example of how phase blending allows us to transition seamlessly between a move start and a move cycle. Halfway through a move start animation, phases are detected and matched with a similar phase in the cycle. There are four phases in this run start, so the system finds the first four phases in the run cycle to match. Then the playback speed of both animations is progressively adjusted so the phases line up. And here's the result. Because the blend is happening over many frames and is masked by the movement of both animations, it's almost impossible to tell where one ends and the other begins. Phases also allowed us to blend between a run start and a walk cycle, or a walk start and a run cycle. So now that we have solutions to blending and transitions, let's go back to our common animation issues and talk about repetitive cycles. We've already solved the repetition problem when it comes to idle animations by extending the animation length, so let's talk about how repetition relates to move cycles. Traditionally, navigation animations are a single cycle, two steps. This requires the animation to be extremely uniform, with minimal nuance, and also removes the ability to have any acting in the performance. To solve this, we created multi-cycle movement animations and used phase blending to keep them in sync regardless of the number of cycles of each animation. On the left, we have a multi-cycle animation. On the right, we have the same animation reduced to a single cycle. At first, the two look very similar, but after watching the animation on the right loop over and over, you start to notice a robotic, repetitive quality to it. No matter how hard you try, each step you take will land in a slightly different place at a slightly different timing, and the body will naturally make subtle weight shifts to keep you moving in a straight line. We found that 3 to 5 cycles was the sweet spot, giving us a variety of movement necessary to keep the animation from feeling repetitive. Now let's talk about strafe blending. Since the order's movement system is based on strafing, we created animations for several movement directions, which are synced up using phase blending. This presented another challenge. How do we switch from forward-type movement to backward-type movement? In our original system, we used 4 directional animations for strafing: forward, back, left, and right. Since left and right were technically forward-type movement, blending between them and backwards resulted in sliding and the legs passing through each other. To solve this, we added sidestep-type movements, which blend correctly between forward and backward-type movement. Because humans favor forward-type movement, we limited backwards to straight back. Because of this, we chose 135 degrees to the left and the right as our sidestep angles for normal movement. While aiming weapons, the body is naturally turned to the right and less biased towards forward-type movement, so we chose 45 degrees to the left and 135 degrees to the right as our sidestep angles for aiming. Next, let's talk about issues with animation playback speed. In the past, we were limited to discrete movement types like walk and run, which were sped up or slowed down to match the player's stick deflection. This leads to unnatural movement that looks either slow-mo or fast-forward. To fix this, we simply added more speed increments. We use phase blending to synchronize all of these movements and play the appropriate ones based on stick deflection. We have 4 standard move speeds: slow walk, walk, jog, and run. The result is sensitive player controls with believable character movement. Moving on to animation layer and split body issues. Animation layers aren't a new concept. They have a lot of great uses in games, but also some pitfalls. There are 2 ways of using animation layers on a joint: additive or replace. Additive layers add animation data together, which is useful when you want to retain motion but change a pose. Replace layers ignore all the animation data beneath them. This is useful when you want to overwrite the motion of other layers completely. In the order, we use animation layers for things like aim offsets and weapon hand grips, among other things. Here's an example of how you use upper body additive animation layers to aim in any direction while retaining the full body motion of the aim idle. We use replace layers for things like arms holding rifles during base navigation, finger grips to match each individual weapon, and hip fire to replace the upper body during base nav. Hip fire and aim animation layers presented us with the biggest challenges. Split body is a feature where you play a different animation on the top and bottom halves of the body. This is extremely useful, but often results in the upper and lower halves of the body feeling disconnected. Because of this, we opted for full body aim strafe animations to keep the body feeling cohesive. For hipfire, we couldn't use full body animations without duplicating our entire movement library, so that wasn't an option. We also couldn't simply replace the upper body with a static pose, because as you can see on the left, that looks really bad. Instead, we replaced the upper body animation and used phases to sync the upper and lower body layers together. This gave us a natural look in every movement direction with only one upper body additive animation. That covers the five main animation issues, but let's add a bonus feature. Pivots are what we call animations that quickly transfer from one movement direction to another. When a real person changes direction, they have to drop their weight down and plant their feet in a way that diverts all of their momentum in a new direction. Creating the animations wasn't too difficult, aside from tuning them aggressively to make them feel more responsive. But finding the right numbers to trigger pivots proved to be much more challenging, and there's still some room for improvement.